We Nendifu Hulisani Ravele. Thank you for firstly clicking on this, which means you want to watch it. But before we play the episode, I thought I would just share a little bit about where this comes from, what the heart to heart is all about. I have had a dream in me for almost a decade now, a dream to produce a world-class talk show on South African soil that really pushes the envelope and sets the standard of how we talk in the country. And so I have been pitching a talk show for at least 6 years now, if I'm not mistaken, since around 2014, to broadcasters, to sponsors, and it's always a bit of the same thing. Either they don't believe in the format because they don't believe in the format, or you're given the runaround of, yeah, we'll look at it at a certain time, we'll get back to it and whatnot. And so 4 years ago in 2016, I decided to back myself. I took up some savings, I applied for an overdraft, I borrowed a little bit of money from a friend, and I was like, I am going to produce this talk show myself. I am going to fund it and I'm going to take it to a broadcaster, and they will license it, and that's that. And so that's what happened in January of 2016. Then we got to edit. We got to edit, and my heart was shattered because we couldn't use any of the footage for at least linear television broadcast quality. It just wasn't good enough. There were so many technical issues, from sound to overexposed shots. Like, just my heart was broken. Forget the money that I'd spent in putting the production together, but just, you know, when you take a step of faith and you're ready to make your dream happen for yourself and back yourself, and then this is what you get back for it. I was just like, what? You've got to be kidding me. And so we never used the footage. It never saw the light of day. And now in 2020, living in a life with COVID-19, the one thing that's really been apparent to me and just speaking to my spirit is just how everybody is kind of like pushing barriers. They are tapping into parts of themselves that they've never had to tap into before. They're just going for it, you know? And a recent conversation I had with a friend of mine, DJ Lloyd Uloiso, I was having an interview on his platform, and he said, just start, my friend. Like, it doesn't need to be perfect. It doesn't need to be all together. Just start. You'll fix it as you go along. And that's a very, very hard concept for me because I'm such a perfectionist. Like, I want everything to be the way that I want it to be. And the show that I'd shot 4 years ago just wasn't it. It wasn't it. But the conversations were, you know. The guests that I had on the show were it. The stories that they told were it. And so that's what I've decided to do, to just take a leap of faith and to take this footage from 4 years ago. You'll see I even have a huge afro back then. And to just put it out into the world. The conversations, I think, are still as important and as relevant, and if not now, more than ever. And it's not perfect, but it's my baby, and it's my first step, you know, into building this talk show that I have in my heart, that I see in my dreams, like, every night. And so I hope you enjoy it. This one, the first episode, is a conversation with one of my favorite people in the world. She's a songstress. She's a sister to me, and just absolute light, absolute light. Enjoy this heart to heart with Lira. Mind 2008, another one. I think that was such a defining album for many people, and being a super fan, I was one of those people. And that's the album where you really speak about self-acceptance and self-love and just self-actualization, self-belief, just loving the self.
When did you struggle the most with self-acceptance?
Throughout my youth, I think.
All's my life, I had to fight.
We gonna be all right. I realized I grew up in a time where, and I watched trends. I mean, just throughout my life, there were trends where thin girls were in, then chubby girls were in, and then curvaceous girls were in, then light girls were in, then dark girls were in. And I'm like, you can't keep up. This is the only version I'm going to have in this life. I cannot keep up with trends. And when you're young, you know, you start comparing yourself with everyone and
so true.
You know, and so, and I remember only when I was in my mid-20s did I realize I never got a chance to decide what I thought of myself. I was in a society that said, that skin tone is beautiful, that kind of hair is beautiful, and I didn't know where I fit it. So I didn't feel like I was pretty or just, I didn't feel like I fit anywhere. So when you're in a state like that and the world has its own trends, you can either be very depressed about who you are or you can look at yourself in the mirror and think, okay, well, so what do I think? I hear what the world says, but what do I think?
Of self.
Yeah, and I only did that like when I was 25, 26. It just blew my mind. So I was a late bloomer in that sense, very late bloomer. But once it happened, you know, it just felt like I was making my own life. I was making my own rules. I was expressing myself my way. There was a great sense of freedom and it was fun. Mm-hmm. It was really, really fun to, I remember the first things was just wearing my hair natural. I remember, you know, they think, oh, you're a strong African woman just because you're in natural. I mean, the perceptions that go with it, or that it's less pretty, it's not as glamorous. And I was determined to make it look beautiful because for me, it really was saying, I can't fit in with all your trends that change every other year anyway.
This is where I'm going to be.
This is who I am. I'm going to love that which I am. So it happened late, but evidently it's never too late.
Look at us, girl. We out here.
I'm loving your hair. You know what I mean? It's just
inspiration. It goes both ways. Absolutely. It really does. And I think it's important for us to be able to show young people out there that this is pretty. This can be your version of pretty, and there's no need to be, you know, but the head debate is one that will never end. So let's rather leave.
But I just want to say, just in terms of that, it's like there is nothing wrong with you. There is nothing wrong with you as you are. I think that's for me, that's the biggest message. I don't care what you put on, but it's just, there's nothing wrong with you.
Yeah. Rise Again is another song that comes off Soul and Mind. That was just, I listened to that song and the tears that just come rolling every time because it's literally, it's a prayer, you know? Yeah. And you speak about making bad choices along the way and that you watch yourself to just rise again. And maybe that's why we fall. We look at people that we admire, such as yourself, and you think, but there were no bad choices that Lira could have made. Right. Seriously? Yeah. And I know we live a life where we don't want to have regrets, but what would you say some of the bad choices you made once upon a time were?
You see, it's tough for me to look at them as bad choices now because I see their purpose.
Mm.
At the time, I was reeling at myself, but I really don't think I made a bad choice. It was really just that everything was a means to an end. There was really a purpose to every single decision. And I mean, I've been asked this question a few times. I really genuinely cannot think of what was bad. Triple Nine was my education. Sony was literally building up my career to the next level. All the partners that I've had along the way, it's been great.
With the good comes the bad. With the success comes the negativity.
Yes.
Yes. We'd be lying if we said, but kaofela barata Lira. She's our girl. And some people are of the opinion that there are many accolades that you have walked away with in the past years, and one of them being the best female category. And they believe that you're not necessarily the best female vocalist in the country. How do you deal with such negativity? Because, I mean, Superman, where you're just like, I'm going to let this bounce.
Well, off. True. I mean, generally I do. I also understand that jealousy makes you nasty, but I work hard, you know, and I've always known that talent alone is never enough. And classic case, you can be the best singer, but you probably don't have an album, for instance.
Sure.
Talent alone, it was never enough. So when you have your talent, you still have to work so hard to become the best that you can be. And I showed up. I showed up in and I'm not going to shrink myself and all the work that I've done in order to make everyone else feel comfortable because they have a better talent. Woo! Roll up your sleeves, do some work.
Preach, sister.
You know.
You're not going to make yourself feel small because of that. Lira wakwata. Actually, let me not say Lira wakwata.
I do.
Lerato wakwata. And what does
actually
that look
both
like?
Of them. And then when they're both angry, it's guguti 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 kwa kwa mafu. There's a storm. I don't enjoy being angry. I'm passionately angry when I get. I don't enjoy it. It's draining. but I can get upset, and you know, it's just. It's things like respect, being respectful of people that you work with, and just being sensitive, you know, in an environment, and you know, just. I think those are some of the things that really just can piss me off when a person just seeks to disrupt something that you're working on. And when that happens, I make my feelings known. If I can say what I need to say in a few words.
Why such a long try?
Why? You know, can I just, so we can move on. Can I just say, this is what
can
you're
I
doing.
Live?
This is how it is. And that's that. And so I know some people want to package certain things, but it's for me, it's better to just get to the point and to be clear. And I like people to communicate with me in the same manner as well. I don't think I'm ever harsh or ugly. I'm not that kind of person. But I am quite direct.
How do you deal with that in the workspace though? Because let's be honest, whether you're in the entertainment industry or work or banking, it doesn't really matter.
Yeah.
There are circumstances and sometimes situations where you need to stand up for yourself and defend yourself. But there's the line between being mean and being direct.
There is a line between the two, but for me, the point is to make a person understand. But I do it in a direct manner. I don't dilly-dally about it, sadly. But I don't think it ever comes across as mean. And what I also try to do is to never confront or shout at a person. Actually, I hardly ever raise my voice. But I don't do it in display of others. I really deal with a person directly. Because I think that's just the worst thing you do. Let's say everyone else is in a good vibe and you crapping on somebody, then you literally ruin the energy for everyone else. And for me, that's never necessary. But then sometimes I have to tackle my whole team, and that's and I'm the only
mistress.
Female. I'm the only female. Actually, my band teased me and called me mommy.
Mom has spoken.
Yeah, so
it is well, but it's important.
I think it really is, especially as a woman, just being surrounded by male energy. It's always important for me to be firm and to stand my ground. Yeah.
Your fifth studio album, which is currently titled Born Free, I mean, anything can happen between now and when the album comes out, will be your first release as an independent artist. That is a pretty big deal. Mm. I had the pleasure of being at your Evolution concert where you spoke of this album and you said that by virtue of being a human being, I am free. I'm free to dream and free to make my dreams come true. Our thinking confines our ability to dream.
Yeah.
When did you release yourself from that?
I think it's been a process. You know, I could say I achieved it the first time I quit my job, but to a degree. So I think I'm becoming emancipated more and more. The more I travel my journey, the more I'm experiencing a sense of freedom. Even now, having the freedom to launch my album as an independent artist is a sense of freedom. So it's really been like a process. Mm. And that's really what I wanted to share with the album is, you know, what are we all actually looking for? You know, we sort of just accept how life is, and we don't sometimes question it, but then we wonder why we're unhappy. So what I'm proposing is think about your life. Think about what you're thinking. Think about what you're doing. Think about what you're accepting. If things don't resonate, it's because they're not for you. So just put some thought behind it and start believing in yourself. And I've just discovered there's nothing more special about me, for instance. It's just I realized certain things and I changed my attitude and I acted a certain way. I acted towards those things. And that's really the difference, is that I thought about it. Mm. And in life, when you do that, when you are consciously considering everything you're doing. Life engages with you. It literally responds. It'll give you the right circumstances. You'll meet the right people, opportunities.
So true.
Things will just show up. So that's, you know, as us, I think also, besides being South African, but perhaps it was also inspired by being South African, is that I remember a time where we felt limited as a people. And a lot of that legacy continues. So it's just to free ourselves up, to realize that it first starts in
the mind,
up here.
Yeah.
That's really, for me, where the real freedom will start. It's completely in one's mind. And once we start accepting our freedom and expressing it, and you did one little thing at a time.
Yeah.
Like I'm saying, for me, it's been a process over all these years. And, you know, you'll find that you make progress. It gets better as the years go on. Mm. So with this album, it's really about our young ones now that are really more freer than a lot of us have been.
That's so true.
But they will be stuck unless they change their thinking.
Wow. Do you think that, I'm going to play devil's advocate for a second, that someone sitting watching this is saying, well, it's easy for you to say that now, Lira, because you've achieved, you know, you're successful. So it's really easy for you to say, free your mind and everything else will fall into place. What would you say to that, your words of encouragement to someone who is in that space that's just like, nah, not for me?
It's very true, but I've been there. What I'm doing is leaving you breadcrumbs as to how I got here. That's really all I'm trying to do. Because we all deserve to be happy. We all deserve to feel a sense of freedom, to live the best life possible. I think that was the plan. Someone along the way lied to us. So we need to take back that. And for me, once you wake up to that reality, I think it is your duty, you have an opportunity to share it with others. And I'm not saying I'm right, I'm just teaching you what I've been able to accomplish. And I feel really privileged that I have a platform where I can share it.
That's powerful.
Yeah, so use it, don't use it, it's up to you.
I love that.
Yeah.
In your book, because now we can say Lira is an author, making her story, the second chapter is titled The Dip That Created the Lift. Mm-hmm. You write about a dark time in your life and a time where you were filled with so much anger and you were hitting so many dead ends that you ended up one night on your bedroom floor just crying yourself to what you described, I cried myself into a state of exhaustion and lifelessness as if to allow death to take over.
Yeah.
What had led you to that much anger and disarray?
I was, okay, so I'd left my job, I'd exhausted all my resources. It had been now 2 years since I left my job, so I felt like a failure. I felt like a complete failure. And I was angry with 999. I was angry with myself. I was ashamed. I was all kinds of feelings. But I had been asking God to just help me make sense of everything.
Mm-hmm.
And it felt like all my prayers were in vain. So I didn't know why I was even here on earth. I just was like, I need answers, you know. I don't understand why you have a talent, but it won't get you anywhere. I don't understand, what are we supposed to do? For me, if my talent felt like a living thing that was sort of scratching and going, pay attention to me, pay attention to me. And now that I did pay attention, I lost everything. I didn't understand. I was just like, so I don't know what I'm supposed to do with my life. And if that's the case, if I have no purpose for living, can I just die? Can I just, you know, if there's no point, can I just, you know? And, you know, through prayer, there was just no responses. So I felt hopeless. There was nowhere else to go. But of course, something incredible happened.
That night.
Something that changed my entire life. This had been months of praying and asking, fasting, and reading the Bible from A to Z. I just wanted somebody to speak to me.
Say something!
And so that night, I was ready to let go. I was just, I don't want to breathe again. Talk to me, you know? And so as I was falling asleep and literally completely giving up 100%, I was suddenly filled with a feeling that made me feel whole. Nothing had changed. I still had no money. I still was broke. I was still a failure as an artist.
Mm.
But I felt full, but like literally a feeling of fullness. That hollow brokenness was, I could feel it mending. I could feel myself just filling up, and I was just like, what is going on? But I understood. And I say there, the God I met is love.
He showed himself to you as love. It filled me.
I just felt full. And I couldn't believe it. I mean, I remember I didn't want to sleep because what if I wake up and it's gone?
It's just for a moment. Money back guarantee in the morning is going to be gone.
I was like, but I was tired as well. You know, I remember, but for hours, I just was feeling this, and it was just like a joy, a fullness. And when I woke up in the morning, I was just, it's still there. Good. Mm. But as I remember, I was energized. I was excited. I don't know what's going to happen, but I feel great. I feel good. So I got up and just the world looked different. Like I was just appreciating the sky, people.
The birds are singing.
Everything. I was just like, oh my God, we live in such a cool planet. I was like, you know, I was just on this natural high. But I was happy. Mm. And I think in the same timeline, I discovered the purpose for my music. When I was depressed, all I saw was just depression and oppression, and it was just difficult in the hood. But now that I felt great, I just saw potential, and I saw the purpose for my music. I understand why people listen to gospel music. They want to feel a sense of joy. In a similar way, I understand why people go to a club and turn up. It's because you just want to feel good. Mm. And so I decided then that I would not sing negative. I have no business being, I don't want to go back there. Mm-hmm. I had no joy from that space. So now I wanted to sing empowering music and music that would keep me in that space. Mm-hmm. And consequently, the people that listen to the music. So that's how I literally made up my story in that sense.
I love how you continued to say literally on the next page that it had all become clear to me. I was in a really great space. I was no longer blaming anyone for how my life had turned out.
Yeah.
So often, I think we stop and blame everybody else but ourselves. Yeah. And that must have been a liberating feeling for you.
Massively, because it meant that I could do something about it. So, you know, it was so easy to blame 999. I mean, shame, they bore the brunt of my state of being at that time. Yeah. And as soon as I realized, oh no, it's cool, I got this, you know. So,
and don't she got it today. You know?
And so the first thing I did was consider what I could do. What do I have? I still have my body, I'm fully abled. I still have my voice, I still have the ability to write, I still have the desire to perform. I literally looked at what was available to me and I started with
building on that.
But the difference was that there was a different attitude. There was a sense of ownership. My destiny is here. And yeah, and I just built bit by bit. Like I said, nothing physically changed. Something within changed. And from then on, I was able to build everything else.
Because there's something inside so strong.
What are you most afraid of?
Not fulfilling my potential. That's actually my biggest, a lot of my fears, I got over them over the years, and every year I would conquer something, and so I feel confident in that, but I realize when I get really stressed is when I feel like things are in my way that threaten my ability to do what I need to do. I don't want to die with stuff still left within me. That probably scares me more than anything. And when you think about the context of how my spiritual journey began, I have this love affair with spirituality that I'm just like, let's go, I'm ready, let's go. And then it's like, if I don't want to not show up because I really have been blessed. It's insane. It's a big contrast from where I started and where I am. It's mind-bogglingly
huge.
Mm-hmm. And so I'm conscious of every day that big things are really happening and just some of the opportunities that are unsolicited that literally land on my lap. I'm just like, really? Mm. It's like, this is so
for
cool.
Me?
You know?
You got my name on it.
So that, you know? So I have a lot of that. And all I want to do is just show up fully. Mm. And so, you know, you'll have naysayers. People that, oh, you don't deserve it. It's not about you. I can assure you it's not about you. I'm here to serve, but most importantly, to be that which I'm supposed to be. And I love the freedom that my spirituality has offered me. It was a freedom in here that manifested in me having resources that freed me up to do what I do. Mm. And that's available to everyone. That's actually, if anything, that's probably the biggest thing I'm pushing. We all deserve it.
You say that you are a result of your grandmother's Telly's prayers. Mm. If you could send a prayer up to her right now, what would you say?
I chat to her all the time. She's my imaginary friend. But, you know, just thank you so much. I mean, Telly was ill for about 7 years. She died when I was in matric. And she was actually quite hectic. She was so hectic. When I was young, I just didn't understand how this woman would be. She was like she was militant. Mm. She had a house full of young people, and she was the leader in the household. So it's a lot of young people, you're not necessarily their mother, and you've got to keep them in the straight and narrow. So she was hard. She was really, really hard. But in so doing, I realized how much she impacted me, because I was just observing. And I remember one time I was actually talking to my mom of how hectic she would be. One time she was, that was quite naughty as well, and I was one of the younger kids, and she sat on me. She literally dominated. She sat on my chest. She was like, she was so hectic. And I was like, why did she have to be so hectic? Mm. But I realized she needed to be that hard to have control in that space. She literally educated everyone in that house. Mm. And if you were old enough, she helped everyone get a job. And I can't help that as well. I just find out I just want to help everyone.
Yeah,
very much. And my mom is the same. I always say my grandmother just adopts people. So we just take people on. But it's the opportunity. It's like you almost can't help it. Mm. And because you can see, it's even more beautiful when a person uses an opportunity that they be given. That's beautiful. That's actually quite priceless. So
Siyabonga Kokteli. On her that day. She is where she is today.
Siyabonga. Very much. Now I love her.
Lastly, why does Lerato Call matter?
I feel like there's two ways to answer that, because firstly, of course, I matter to me. Mm-hmm. How I feel within me is there's a very clear sense of purpose. And I realize that it impacts more than just myself. Mm-hmm. And that part of it is the reason why it matters that I need to matter to me as well. I'm here to leave a legacy, I guess. But the beautiful thing about life is that when you honor yourself, you inevitably become a light for everyone else.
Amen and amen. Yeah. Lira, you are light. You inspire so many with your work and your essence. Never hide your light.
Ah, love
Thank
that.
You.
Thank you so much.
Nothing can ever be right until we choose to make it right. We can be the reason why. We can keep a hope alive. We can be the right ones, the right ones for the times. We've been the missing part.